Hello everyone. Let's dive right into 9.3, Growth of Plants. This is a higher level lecture and our third on botany. Here we're really going to be looking at how plants grow, obviously. Specifically looking at the regions in which they grow, called meristems, and looking at the effect of various hormones on their growth, such as auxin, which promotes phototropism. So some fun words coming up. Now, let's begin. Undifferentiated cells in the meristems of plants allow indeterminate growth. So a few things here that you should immediately pick up on. Undifferentiated. Where was the last time we heard about undifferentiated cells that can differentiate and can divide? Stem cells. So these are basically stem cells in the plant. And just like our skin has stem cells that grows our new layers of skin, and in our bone marrow, in the ossobuco, you have hematopoietic stem cells that make all the different types of blood in your body. Plants have their own versions of stem cells that allow them to grow new cells. These stem cells in plants are in areas called meristems. So this is where the plant's stem grows from, meristem, and you have to know that word. Now this allows indeterminate growth. Indeterminate means unended, unending. Plants can keep growing through their whole lives, and that continued growth is indeterminate, as in it's not predetermined, it can continue, right, determine. So again, undifferentiated cells in the meristems of plants allow indeterminate growth. Now there are two types of meristems, apical and lateral. So meristems are these embryonic stem cell regions in plants where plants grow. Now, animals tend to grow everywhere. When you go from a baby human to an adult human, everything gets bigger. Fingers get bigger, arms get longer, legs get longer, the head gets bigger, the torso gets bigger, everything gets bigger. Whereas in plants, when I look at a plant that grows new branches, etc., the leaves stay the same size. A baby plant and an adult plant have leaves of the same size. They don't get bigger. So unlike humans, where everything gets bigger, in plants, that's not what happens. They grow in meristems, in regions, with other things just staying the same size. So meristems are regions where cells continue to divide and grow, often throughout the whole life of the plant. And cells in the meristem go through the cell cycle quickly. So they're doing cytokinesis again and again and again and again. So these are good places to look for cells in mitosis if you're ever doing a lab on that. Now, as I said right at the beginning, there are two main types of meristems, apical and lateral meristems. Apical meristems are sometimes called primary meristems, and it comes from the word apex. So these, apex, by the way, means the tip. So this is growth at the tip of the plant, meaning the roots and the tips of the branches. This is growth at tips. Meanwhile, lateral meristems, lateral means width. So these increase the width of a plant. So if I look at a picture here, a lateral meristem are things that are right in the middle of the plants. Think tree rings that grow in each year to make the plant wider, or inside leaves and can make leaves thicker. Whereas apical meristems are at the tips, these buds here. And they grow, and they always grow the same way, two new leaves and one new branch. Or at the tips of roots, you have apical meristems. Now, mitosis and cell division in the apex of the shoot provide cells needed for the extension of the stem and development of leaves. So basically, apical meristems are how the tips of branches grow. So again, the apical meristem is found at root and stem tips. Another word for a stem, by the way, is a shoot. So I can use both of those words. The joke always is that pandas eat shoots and leaves, right? That's why they're such terrible members in your bar. If a panda ever walks into your bar, be careful. They eat. What does a panda do in a bar? It eats, shoots, and leaves. Anyway, bad jokes aside, shoots and stems are the same thing. So the shoot apical meristem is more complex than the root because it also needs to make leaves and flowers. And apical meristems tend to add in units. You can actually see this in bamboo, and I'll talk more about that in just a sec. So the apical meristem is where leaves and flowers grow, and they can remain embryonic for a very long time. The tips of a branch will often keep growing as a tree gets older and older. So here's a cross-section of an apical meristem, and you can actually see where the shoot will be, where the baby leaves will be, where the next branches are going to go off, and where the original stem tissue is. Here you can see an apical meristem of a root, where again you have the root cap. That's where kind of the micro, not microvilli, but the root hairs are. And you can also see the apical meristem, and you can see these various levels of meristem. But here is where most of the mitosis is happening. Here, by the way, is the xylem and phloem in F. Now, again, apical growth is happening here at the tips, right? Lateral growth is happening here, making the plant grow wider and wider and wider. As I mentioned before, apical growth often is in tips, and you literally see this in bamboo. So bamboo has these pieces, and every piece has the same number of leaves and is the same length, and then a new piece grows. Apical growth often happens in these modules or units. Now, lateral growth is the cambium. So if we look at the cambium here, that's the part between the xylem and the phloem. And the cambium makes the tree wider by growing wider and wider and wider, and then it will actually grow a new vascular, it'll grow a new xylem and phloem. And over time, you get more and more rings as those cambiums divide. On average, about one new ring per season. And that's what actually allows you to date a tree. So as you go from a smaller one to a bigger one, you can see a new ring being added. So again, apical meristems at the tip, while lateral meristems or secondary meristems are inside the tree, and they make the tree wider and wider and wider. Apical meristems are located at the tips of the roots and shoots. They increase the length of the plant, producing new leaves and flowers, while lateral meristems or secondary meristems with the cambium are found in the vascular bundles and increase the diameter of the plant. They produce a new xylem and phloem. In the stems of younger plants, the vascular cambium is normally in its own bundles, but in older plants, it forms a complete ring. Now, let's talk a little bit more about how plants grow. So, plant hormones control the growth of the shoot apex. A hormone is any chemical message that's produced in one part of a living thing and affects another part. So, by the way, during puberty, your body is full of hormones. A lot of those hormones are either released by a part of your brain, like the pituitary, or by your gonads, testes, and ovaries. And in puberty, that causes growth and development in other parts of your body. Now, plants also have hormones, which are released in one part of the plant to have an effect in another part. One example of this are cytokinins. You don't need to know this word, don't worry about it, but these are produced in the root. And they produce growth of the axis or the tip of the root. Don't memorize this example. This example, though, you might as well memorize because you're going to need to know it for 9.4. These are hormones that contribute both to stem elongation, but for 9.4, you'll need to know that this is the hormone that causes a seed to start growing into a tree. So, gibberellic acid or gibberellins are the hormone that cause seed growth. You're going to need to know that eventually. Now, the hormone you do need to know for this lecture, for 9.3, is auxin. Auxin is a hormone that initiates the growth of roots and cell elongation in the stems of plants. It promotes the stem to grow longer. It's a form of apical growth. It promotes mitosis in some cells and cell enlargement or getting longer in another. And this is what auxin actually looks like. You don't need to memorize that. So auxin is super important because it's involved in tropisms. A lot of plants grow in tropisms. Now, a tropism is a bending growth towards or away from a stimulus. So for example, there are tropisms having to do with both light and gravity. Stems will grow towards sources of light. What's the scientific prefix for light? It's photo. So this is growing towards light is phototropism. Growing against gravity, so up against gravity, is gravitotropism. So specifically in phototropism, what we're seeing here is when there's sun above, it's actually the tip of the stem that releases auxin, these hormones, and these hormones are going to go into the shady side of the cell, of the plant, to make the cells on the shady side get longer, which curves the plant towards light. That's phototropism. And phototropism, again, this one you have to know, that's why it's bolded, is directional growth towards a source of light, and it's controlled by auxin. Gravitotropism is another example of a tropism, or gravitropism. It's growth in response to gravity. So people on the ISS orbiting the Earth do a lot of studies on gravitropism. That said, not an example you need to know, but it's an interesting real-life one. Phototropism, the growth of a plant towards light, you do need to know. And technically that's positive phototropism because it's towards. Negative would be away. So I actually want to show you a video of this. So here I'm going to show a little video of some cute baby tomato plants following light. And the way that they follow light is actually by growing. First growing, if the sun's here, the shady side grows, so it bends that way. And then as this side gets longer, it bends the other way. And then this side gets longer and it bends the other way. That's how tropism works. And here are these baby tomato plants doing that. So you need to know that auxin influences cell growth rates by changing the pattern of gene expression. That's how they actually do it. Auxin is produced in the tip of the stem or the shoot, right? So right at the tip of the plant. And then pumps are going to move it to the darker side of the plant. There, it's going to alter gene expression. So it's going to change the methylation patterns of the DNA in those cells. And it's going to cause genes that have to do with cell growth, things like cyclins, right, to do the cell cycle faster, causing cells on the dark side to elongate and divide and grow faster. So that means that the darker side is going to grow more, which causes the plant to bend. And that's because auxin produced in the tip of the plant is going to move to the dark side, just like Darth Vader. Now, this actually happens because shoot tips have proteins called phototropins, and phototropins are basically receptor proteins on the cell membranes that absorb light. And when they change shape because they absorb the light, they cause auxin to be released and made. So these phototropisms are stimulating the transcription and translation of genes for auxin and the pumps that are going to move it to the dark side.
Growth in plants reflects the way in which they interact with the environment. If we place a strong light at one side of this fuchsia plant, the plant will grow towards it. This is called a phototrophic response. But what controls such a response? If the tip of the plant is protected from the light using a small cap, the plant will continue to grow upward. This suggests that there's something at the tip of the plant that controls the direction of growth. If we place this fuchsia plant on its side, it quickly recovers its orientation and grows upward. But is the plant responding to light or to gravity? These pea seeds are germinating in the dark, yet the roots are growing down and the shoots are growing up. The roots and shoots must be responding to gravity, but in different ways. The roots are said to be positively geotropic, and the shoots negatively geotropic. It is probable that all of these growth responses are due in some part to the auxin indole acetic acid, or IAA. One theory states that a light-sensing mechanism in the tip of the fuchsia plant promotes the active transport of IAM molecules to the shaded part of the stem. This action produces cell growth and elongation in this area. The result is a curvature which orientates the plant towards the light. A gravity-sensing mechanism in the shoot tip triggers a similar migration of IAM molecules, producing growth in the stem which orientates the plant from a horizontal position back to a vertical position. The growth substance IAA also appears to have a role in maintaining apical dominance. By removing the growing tip, which controls auxin distribution and therefore apical dominance, lateral buds can grow. An important hormone in deciduous plants is abscisic acid, which controls leaf fall, thereby protecting the plant from adverse seasonal conditions.
On that note, you do need to know that auxin efflux pumps, efflux meaning kind of export, set up that concentration gradient, where you have more auxin on the dark side of the plant. So phototropisms change shape more on one side of the plant, the side with sunlight, than the other side, which activates pumps on that side, pumping the auxin to the other side of the plant. That means that the auxin is going to work to change the cell wall. It does this using proton pumps, but that's way more than you need to know. But those proton pumps change the acidity, which makes the cell wall more flexible, which helps the cells grow. That's more than you need to know. You do need to know that the plant can detect light. It detects the light more on the bright side, which causes pumps to be activated that are going to pump auxin, from which is produced in the shoot tips, from one side of the plant to the dark side of the plant. So the cells in the dark side of the plant grow more, and that growth makes the plant bend towards light. So leaves attached to the stems will get more light because they're bending towards it. And what's cool is people have done lots and lots of experiments about this. They've done it, first off, so this is Darwin, the Darwin, doing experiments on this. So he put light on one side of a full stem and found that the whole stem bent. Then he actually cut off the tip. And this was very clever because when he cut off the tip, the plant did not bend. So that allowed Darwin to hypothesize that whatever hormone was causing the plant to bend was being made in the tip. And you have to know that auxin is made in the tip of the plant, the tip of the shoots and the stems. Then he wanted to see if light was being detected there. So he actually put a cap to cover the tip of the plant, like literally a black little hat. And the plant did not bend. So that's how he knew that the phototropins that are changing light, changing shape to detect light was also in the tip of the plant. And then he tried burying the plant, because by burying the plant, you're basically meaning that the whole bottom half is in the dark. And when he did that, the plant still bent. When he took it out of the ground, it was bent towards light. So really, that was Darwin's way of proving that auxin was being made in the tip, and that the difference in brightness was being detected in the tip of the plant. Then, to kind of work on these pumps, he actually, not Darwin, but Boyan Jensen in 1913, took a little sheet and kind of cut halfway through the plant. And when they cut halfway through the plant, in on the side that's in the dark, they found that the plant did not bend because the pumps were not able to pump the auxin to the cells in the dark side. However, when he put it in the light side, the plant still bent because auxin from the tip was still being pumped to the dark side of the plant. So these are some really clever experiments that helped us figure out how this all worked before science was good enough to actually find auxin and phototropins.
When Darwin placed a blindfold on a growing coleoptil, he observed that the plant no longer grew toward the light. This suggested that something in the tip of the coleoptil was responsible for this directed growth. Other experiments demonstrated that even when the tip is removed and a layer of agar placed between the tip and the base, the plant still grows toward the light. This suggests that the light-sensitive signal can travel through a permeable barrier, directing the plant's growth. If the severed tip is replaced on the growing shoot so that it covers only half of the exposed cut, the side touching the tip grows faster than the other side, causing the coleoptil to curve, even in the dark. This demonstrates that the signal does not migrate across the shoot. The Dutch botanist Fritz W. Wendt wanted to find out if he could isolate this signal from the coleoptil tips. First, he removed the tips of oat plant coleoptils. Next, he placed the detached tip onto a block of agar. After 1 hour, he discarded the tip and positioned the agar on decapitated coleoptils in such a way that the block only covered half the exposed cut. What do you suppose happened when Wendt placed the agar back on the decapitated coleoptil? Click on the coleoptil on the right that represents the likely result of this experiment. When Wendt placed the agar block on one side of the decapitated shoot, the shoot curved away from the agar as it grew. This demonstrated that some kind of hormonal signal had diffused into the agar from the coleoptil tips. This hormone had then diffused into the growing coleoptil. The hormone, subsequently called auxin, caused the growing plant to curve, even in the absence of light. Wendt's experiment represented the first time that anyone had isolated a hormone from plants.
Now, you have to know phototropism. You have to know that auxin is produced in the tip of the plant and light is detected by phototropins, which causes auxin to be pumped from the light side to the dark side. So there's a higher concentration of auxin in the dark side of the plant, which causes increased growth of the dark side, which causes the plant to grow towards the light, and this is called positive phototropism. Now, again, another example, you know, just for fun, gravitropism is also auxin dependent. You don't need to know this, but it's cool. So if you place a root on its side, gravity causes organelles to accumulate more on one side because they sink to the bottom. So auxin transport goes to the bottom, which causes it to bend more, and it bends up, helping those leaves and flowers go more towards the light. And that's just kind of cool. So we've talked about meristems and growth in plants, and we've talked about phototropism controlled by auxin. So one more thing in this lecture. Micropropagation. Now basically, propagation, what does that mean? Propagation means to make more of. I can propagate my ideas by sharing them with you and hoping that you will then propagate them and tell them to your friends. Micro means small. So this is making more of things using a small piece. And what this basically involves is I know that the meristem is the part of the plant that grows. So if I just take out little pieces of the meristem, you know, if I take a whole bunch of apical meristems, just cut off all the tips of plants and put them in dirt, will all of those tips grow into full plants? Yes, actually. If I take a small piece of the plant, micro, I can use it to make many more versions of the plant, propagation. And I can do this by taking tissue from the shoot apex, that's the apical meristem, then putting it in nutrient agar and give it the right growth hormones, and it'll grow. So micropropagation is a technique that's used to produce large numbers of identical plants. And it's because plants can actually reproduce asexually. If you just take all their meristems, it'll grow into full new plants. And that's because meristems are stem cells. They're undifferentiated cells capable of growth. Now, when you do this in its native environment, it's called vegetative propagation. You don't need to know this, but the really cool thing is that this is how all bananas are made. Technically, every banana you eat are probably clones of each other from the exact same banana tree that has been micropropagated. So it's actually different trees, but they all have the exact same DNA. They're clones, because instead of using seeds to make new trees, we actually cut the trees apart, take their meristems, and plant the meristems. So it's all the same tree that just keeps regrowing to make the types of bananas that you really like, and never a different one. The one you need to know, though, is when we do this in a lab. And this is called micropropagation, when you do it in the lab, so in petri dishes. And this basically involves taking a specific plant, sterilizing it so there's no bacteria on it, taking a tissue sample, that meristem, and growing it in an agar gel, and then giving it all of the hormones it needs, things like gibberellins and auxin, to stimulate shoot and root development. Then you can keep taking these shoots and you can keep cutting them in half, and doing this again and again until you have as many baby plants as you want. And once the baby plants are big enough, you can actually transfer them to soil. So you take the plant, take a little bit of the meristem, grow it with hormones, and once it gets big enough, you can actually put it into the soil. Now, you don't need to know these stages, but you should know the basic process of this. And we can use micropropagation to very, very quickly get new varieties of plants. You know, if you just spread a new type of flower you want to sell, this is an easy way of getting a lot of that type of flower without waiting for the seeds. You can also make virus-free strains and getting many more of rare types of plants, like orchids. So as far as rapid bulking, that's just using micropropagation to make many, many many, many individuals of one type of plant you like. Making virus-free strains. Viruses normally travel through the plant's vascular system. In us, our vascular system is blood. In plants, it's the xylem and the phloem. And because you're using the cambium, the meristem, not the xylem and the phloem, by micropropagation, you can make virus-free plants because it's the part that's not infected. You can also get lots of rare species that don't have enough seeds to reproduce normally. And that's very important, especially if you want to sell rare plants. Okay, so that was the use of micropropagation to make many versions of one type of plant, producing virus-free strains, and of rare species. So, we're done with 9.3. Thanks for watching, and ciao.